He actually ran in LA once, the Necromancer series, which apparently is a German necrophilia romantic horror movie series. And there were two of them. There's Necromancer really and Necromantic 1 and Necromantic 2.
Of course. Who made those?
It's somebody in Germany with a weird sense of humor or something. But it was like this guy who had this obsession, and he kept the corpse in his shower. And he'd go in there, and he had a girlfriend also, and it was horrible.
Was it at Toronto Film Festival?
No, it was in, it may have been at some point. It was before I really started going to film festivals, but it was in LA. There was a website called, or not a website back then, it was a magazine called Film Threat.
Okay.
And they did a little mini festival of kind of obscure horror films from over the world, across the world. And yeah. Is this a long-standing partnership, or is this come together for this one movie?
No, it's just this one movie. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. That was one of the jokes you're supposed to laugh.
So how did this all? How did this film start? How did this project start?
Well, it started with me writing it 4 years ago. I always wondered why our nation wants to portray itself as the good and helping nation, which seems like, especially now, we're really not. Closing down borders, holding out refugees, you know. And they always make movies about how good we are. So I wanted to make a movie about that. We actually may also do the an eye for an eye thing, that whole mentality, I feel just give birth to, yeah.
And is this a well-known story?
No, it's not. It's, I mean, a few people heard about it, but it's what I would call an untold story of our country.
So did you look for a story once you kind of had the idea of the theme you were looking for? Did you come upon the story?
No, but like any other director, you know, I sit and Google a lot. And then I suddenly looked at this page called the Danish Pioneer Corps, which was supposed to clear the mines. They were educated during the war. And then I found out that they actually forced the Germans, young Germans, to do it instead. And then I slowly started researching into it and started writing, so, yeah.
And the script came quickly, easily?
Or no, it took 3.5-4 years to write. Not sitting all the time, but, you know, working on other stuff. But
yeah
with the financing and everything, it took a while.
So were people enthusiastic about financing a film on this
In Denmark, the government helps you a lot. We have film funding and stuff. And so it's my third movie, and it wasn't difficult to finance, you know. We have a great system in Denmark that helps us finance it. So.
And then you came into his life.
Yeah, and he's been happily ever since.
Yes.
No, I think it was a little bit of a struggle when Martin decided that I should play the role for Martin. I don't think that the many people agreed with him that I should play the role.
No. Why?
Well, it's because Roland's been, you know, he's quite new to the film business. 5 years ago, he wasn't working as an actor. I think it came by actually a mistake. You had an idea for another movie, helped out with another movie, and they found out that, okay, this guy has talent. And he played a supporting role in that movie, and it won an award. And then he did another movie, won another award. And I thought to myself, it's time this guy gets a lead.
So you were doing craft service, and they said you should be in the movie.
I was a consultant on the manuscripts, and then I also helped them with the casting. It was a movie taking place in an environment that I have some experience with. Mm-hmm. And then when I was helping him with the casting, I also said, you cannot sit like this. You must go like this. And why don't you try to do this? And all of a sudden, the instructors were looking at me, and they was like, you're going to play a role. I was like, no, I'm not going to play it. Then I went home, thought about it. I saw Quentin Tarantino in his own movie, and for Hitchcock, I thought, maybe the girls would like me if I have a small role in it. So I said to this guy, okay, give me a small role. And then when we were on the set, they hired me as an instructor, consultant also. And then there was some scene that didn't work out with the actors that they had. And then they said, can you try to do the scene? And I did it. And then we finished the movie. And 8 months later, he said, do you want to see the movie? I said, yeah. And all of a sudden, I was the second biggest role in the movie.
Mm. Yeah.
So that's how I got into it.
Yeah.
So did acting, was there any kind of concept for you of what acting was or how to do it, or you just kind of went with your instinct?
I went with my instinct, my gut feelings. And I also don't say yes to a role if I don't feel I can contribute with something for it. And when Martin called me and said he asked me if I could speak German, and I said, yes, I'm fluent in German. I wasn't quite that fluent, I found out later. It's because my grandma is German. She taught me German the same time as Danish, but she died when I was 19, so I haven't spoke German. I'm in my 40s now, and I haven't spoke German since, so I had to get back into to the language. But then I read the manuscripts, and I was immediately hooked on it because I could. It was my story from my own life. You know, I had a period where I was walking in the darkness and trying to go out into the light, you know, and this is what my character in this movie is all about. So, so I felt strongly for my character in this movie, and it's just a good script because when I heard about it, what is it about? Some boys clearing mines on the beach. I was like, oh, that sounds a little boring, but as soon as I read the story, I was hooked.
Mm. Mm. And did you know his backstory? I guess it must be known in.
I know his backstory. I mean, but I also know he's extremely talented, and he works really hard. He practiced really a lot, and we were while we were doing it, we were sitting in the summer house, you know, rehearsing the scenes and stuff. And he's very, very talented. It comes natural to him, you know. It's the way he says line compared to a lot of other actors, which, you know, they can rehearse and rehearse and rehearse, and it always sounds like an actor. He's got a very special talent, but like you said, it was in the beginning it was a bit of a struggle because he's not well known. I could have chosen a star, which the distribution company would have loved. So they
you
also
did
took
a star.
They took but I mean, in their eyes, they took away a lot of the financing at one point, which of course is understandable.
Yeah,
and that's how it works. So you make it for a little less than, but I think it was the biggest gift for the movie.
Well, I like a good challenge. When I heard that people didn't believe me or anything, I was like, okay, now I got to show them. So that was my motivation actually.
So did you go to these dark places in your other films that you acted in, or is this a new thing?
No, it's not a new thing. The other movies I did, I intimidate people, so I knew I could do that. I knew I won a prize for intimidating people on screen, so I knew that part I had locked down. The hardest challenge in this movie was that I had to get some empathy and touch people's heart, you know, and I have these transitions in the movie. That was the hard part.
Yeah.
But before the premiere the day before. This elderly woman, she came to me and said, you made me cry. I said, I'm sorry I made you cry, but I'm happy I touched you. And then she gave me a long, big hug, and that's when I realized, okay, maybe you did a good job here.
Then see, girls like you after it turned out you're acting.
Yeah, elderly girls, they like me.
No, but it was, we talked a lot about the transformation of his character, Carl. So, yeah.
Mm. So, tone in this piece is one of the interesting, tricky things. I mean, it is a rather relatively simple idea, but it's so intimate. It's always it's like a taking a kind of very basic idea and then just really diving deep into emotion.
Yeah,
because that's really all you have.
Yeah,
you don't have a lot of, you know. You kind of know that a bomb will go, a mine will go off every once in a while, but
yeah,
all you have to do is all it really is that anticipation and reconsideration and reconsideration and reconsideration.
Yeah. But that's where Martin is good.
Yeah, yes, but it's also, you know, it depends on how you do it. You know what I mean? If you look at the first scenes when the boys has to go into this bomb shelter and detach disarm the first real mines. Normally, you in regular movies you would make that three boys and then one would blow up.
Mm-hmm.
What we do here is that we use, you know, 14 boys, and you tend to forget that, okay, maybe nobody's going to blow up. You have no idea who's going to blow up, when or what. You know that something's probably going to happen, but maybe not this scene, maybe next scene. So it's also playing with that kind of shock effect.
With the twins, you kind of know that somebody's got to go eventually.
You know, but
as a moviegoer, you kind of like the twins are like, oh, that's a signal.
You know, but you still don't know when, yeah. And you don't know how, and you don't know, but yeah, you know.
And you don't know how.
But you also know. You also know Titanic's gonna sink. You also know this is what movie's all about. It's about trying to catch the audience, you know, feelings and tension, and can we relate to these characters that are in there? And you know, we still hope that somebody might survive, or that he will change and rescue, or whatever.
So you have a lot of young actors in this movie. Is that a challenge, or are they all very experienced?
No, they're all amateurs. I mean, I don't think it was. They're all very talented. I don't think it. That wasn't the biggest challenge on the movie. But of course, they're teenagers. Offset, they like to, you know, they're.
Be teenagers.
They're teenagers. they make trouble offset. So, but on set, I think, you know, there was, not to mention any names, but there was an episode of they think they're on what you call undiable. They're on, you know,
immortal,
yeah. Exactly. And some of them didn't give a shit about the movie. You know, they don't care. They're immortal. They can do whatever they want. And but sometimes you have to say, hey, this is how it is. You're going to do this, and if you don't, I'm going to blow you up tomorrow, and you can go back.
So where did you find them? It sounds like you picked them up at a high school somewhere.
No, I'm a very big fan of Michael Haneke. Mm-hmm. I used his caster, Simon Baer, who helped me street cast and find the boys I was looking for. I wanted some faces I hadn't seen before, some special guys.
So were any of them trained actors? Or?
A few of them were. The guy who plays Sebastian and Helmut had acted before, but the rest of them were pretty much amateurs. The twins had never done anything before.
Hmm. So how do you direct an actor who's never acted before?
I mean, first of all, I think I can't teach them to act. They have to be themselves, you know. But what they did is that, you know, they just participated with who they were, and they just came into the scene and were so believable. And then I just sat on the side, fed them with lines, you know.
Also did a smart thing with they didn't know what role they were going to play.
That's true. And during the casting process, they all the boys just came into a room and they rehearsed for all the boys, so they didn't know. Also, a lot of the boys didn't know when they were going to be blown up, so they didn't know whether they were going to go to the end of the movie and go home to Germany, or they were going to be blown up. But then I just sit there and I feed them with thoughts and ideas, and you know, talk about your brother, talk about your future, talk about your bricklaying company and what you're going to do, and then they just
grab it
and take it and.
So was it fun being the adult in the room?
No, it's never fun. It's never fun being the adult. I might want to fool around. I had my standoffs with the boys once in a while, because sometimes I felt like they felt like they were on a vacation. So I was a little rough on them two times where I had to, the next day I had to call them over and say, hey boys, I'm sorry. But it was my own insecurity, you know, but there was a lot of stake for me here, on stake. Mm-hmm. And they were just fooling around, and then I kind of like, what the fuck, you think this is vacation, blah, 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 you know. And then next day I was like, well, boys, I'm sorry for this. But I got a lot of sympathy when I apologized for them. That's when I gained their respect, I think. And they realized, okay, this I said, once it's shut, it's forever. So let's do the best we can. Yeah. Come on, boys. And then afterwards, we can play. It's no problem. But let's take this seriously when you're on a job right now. You're not on vacation.
It's the difficult part, 14-year-old, 15-year-old
yeah.
boys.
I remember when I was young, immortal, and stupid. Now I'm just stupid, you know. It's, you get a little smarter.
But you had the same experience, I guess, with your first film of being not a professional.
It's a lot of pressure, but you know, remember we're talking about, you know, should he, as Carl the sergeant, not have a relationship with the kids? Should we keep them separate so they would always fear him? Because I wanted to, I wanted to have real fear in their eyes. So when we shoot them, you know, here comes the sergeant. Shit, he comes driving in his Jeep. What if they hadn't met him before? But during the casting, we already found out that, God, these boys are so nice. They're so good boys. And we it was during the football world championship, so we were actually sitting together at night watching football, clearing minds during the day and watching football at night. It was,
So that was not the biggest challenge. What was the biggest challenge?
For me, it was definitely surprising with the sand. I mean, I thought I had written a simple story in one location, and then, you know, all hell just comes when you walk out to the sand, because sand is very difficult to make films on. It's
so animals, and so are children.
Footsteps all over. I could just imagine how, I mean, we shot this in 6.5 weeks, and I thought, okay, I got one location, I got plenty of time to direct. As soon as you took one take, you know, okay, we got a million footsteps all over. Shit, what to do now? And it caught us by surprise, but we managed. That was it's a big challenge just being out in the nature in general.
So you figured it out?
Yeah, of course.
But there was a lot of waiting time when they cleared the sand, and when I was walking from one of the banks towards the camera, I needed to take like 15 minutes to walk around, not to make the footsteps, and so there was a lot of waiting, but it was worth it. And the thing about being on a location where it actually happened, and the sand it comes in your eyes and in your beard, and there's a lot of wind blowing, and the water is right next to you, and everything, it just adds to make it more realistic for me.
It's the real location where it actually happened.
We found a real landmine, I told you.
So can you feel it when you're there?
Totally. I think when you come in the morning, it has this wow effect. It's the only untouched area in Denmark on the whole west coast. And when we drove down there and park your car and then just walk into the set, it's amazing.
It's an amazing landscape down there.
Is it untouched by law, or is it untouched because
it's a military base now?
It's a military area, so it's untouched. There's no houses, there's no buildings. It's there's nothing. There's no little path where people have walked. There's no footsteps at all. When you get there in the morning, not one single footstep.
Mm. So does the military have to approve your script to use their space? Or?
No. But they were very helpful, having guys help and no. No, in Denmark you don't have to get approval for anything. That's the good thing about the country.
Okay, I didn't know.
One of the good things.
Yeah. And what is it? So you're here in Toronto presenting the film to the world at one big leap. What is that experience like? Is the rest of the world very important to you? Is it your future, or is it just a circumstance that you as part of selling a movie, or how is it for you?
It's both. It's very, very, very excited and thrilled to be here in Toronto. I love Toronto Film Festival also because it's an audience festival. So when we showed it the other night, it was so overwhelming that people actually, you know, it's the audience that sits there. But I also hope that, you know, that it's like it will probably do in Europe, you know, create a lot of debate that, you know, how to treat people, not to become, you know, not to have that eye for an eye mentality, that, you know, the way we treat refugees in Europe right now, the way the Americans treated the prisoners at Guantanamo, the way people in general are, hate just gives birth to something ugly, and it doesn't bring us humans closer to any kind of peace. So I think, you know, I hope it will open that debate that, you know, or give something that we need to change as people, you know. We might all have that hate inside us, as Carl do as the character, but it's important to change and look at each other as we basically simple human beings, just with the same needs for love and affection and all that.
And I thought I believe was all blind. And for me also, my character, there's something about when you fight monsters, you must be aware that you don't become one yourself. And then I think Nietzsche said something like, when you glance into the abyss also glance into you. Mm-hmm. And we need to start thinking in a different way if we want to make the world a better place. For me, that's what's in between the lines in this movie. And then also, I think it's interesting that some movies they portray like the good guys like all good, and the bad guys like really evil. And we as humans are not like that. We all have a good side and a bad side in us. And that's what my character is all about. Yeah. He's fighting. He knows what's right, but he's not doing the right thing. And that's what we all are doing every day. We have to face our evil sides, or demons, or whatever you want to call it. You know, and that's what this character is really all about. Mm. And I hope that when people, especially in Denmark, they see the movie, I hope that they realize, I know it's a cliche, but when you point fingers at others, there's three fingers pointing back at you, you know, and then think about how you treat others and why you do it.
It's also why the title, to make that little thing about my land, mine land, or you know, land of mine, it's what is it? Is it because it's, we're also afraid of people coming into our country, afraid of what we have, afraid of our values, afraid of our jobs, afraid of giving anything up, you know. And I think it's, you know, it's all a part of really capitalism. Just, we have what we have. Don't take it, it's mine. I don't care whether you're, you know,
but that changes our values when we think like that. Because we want to be seen as helpful people and generous people, and when we think like, hey, don't come to our country, you know, then we're the opposite. So the patriotism, it bites you in the back somehow, you know.
So was this all in your mind when you started down this road, when you started writing the script?
It was definitely in our mind, because it's the way we portray ourselves as a nation. It's the way we see ourselves as the helpful nation. You know, all the history books tell us about, and it's not just Denmark, it's any other country.
It seems extremely timely, given what's going on right now.
Remember how we were with our communists, Japanese, everybody was just, we treat people like hell, you know, and we should start treating each other better. And so yes, it was. It's the eye for an eye mentality. It makes us all losers, you know. It doesn't work. And this was the reason why I wanted to do this movie, is because now we suddenly become like them, you know. And it just doesn't work.
So is there a sense that Denmark had a period of time after all this moment where that wasn't the way it was, now that the immigration in the UK and the through Europe has changed?
Yeah, we're scared.
That this has changed in Denmark as well?
Of course it does.
And the German occupied us once, the Sweden had occupied Denmark a couple of times, and Denmark, we're not that big a country, so we're scared of something we don't know. Mm-hmm. And we see the immigrants as someone coming and taking over our country, you know, and we want to keep a little safety in our little country, you know, but that's not healthy for us in any ways. And also, my character, you know, as soon as he get to know these boys, he realized that they are humans just like you. They have the same needs, and they need love and stuff like that, and that's what helps him changing. You know, often, if you want to solve a problem, you need to understand it. And if you have an enemy and you don't understand the enemy, and you just portray him as the bad guys, you know, it's easy to hate him, and then you never solve the problem. But my character, when he gets to know these boys, he starts getting sympathy for him, and that's maybe the solution for all wars, is that we sit down and talk and look each other in the eye and try to understand why we are like we are.
Mm. Well, the Denmark has not really been a big warring country in the last.
We're helping, but it also just the way we're helping, for your taste,
I guess.
Yeah, right. Yeah, but you see what happened, you know, the terrorists, we are a goal for terrorists now. We have not been that before. And we're just a small country where we contribute with a couple of planes who's bombing down there, you know, but now we're in a war. Why? Yeah.
But we also had the Muhammad drawings.
Why?
You know, it makes no sense. It, you know, treat people like you want to be treated.
It's
you know.
It's pretty simple, actually.
What's interesting is the Michael Moore documentary that's here, that's premiering here, Where to Invade Next, I guess it's called, is all about going to other countries and looking at what's good about them and bringing it back to the United States.
Yeah.
Because
yeah?
We've forgotten, you know, different principles of humanity. And I don't, he doesn't go to Denmark, I think he goes to Sweden, but no. He
but I think all
takes something back from each of these countries that we wish we had.
Yeah.
Yeah, I understand why he goes to Sweden instead of Denmark. The refugees don't want to stay in Denmark either. They want to go to Sweden. They just want to pass through Denmark. And yeah. We don't even allow them to pass through. But what if somebody stayed? Well, you know?
Yeah. So they have the trains at the border. Not letting them in, which is wild.
Luckily, I just saw pictures that yesterday there was like 40,000 Danish people on the streets protesting against the politics we're doing for the refugees right now, and that's good. Something is working now.
Yeah, it's also the reason why, you know, why is everybody suddenly talking about the Syrian refugees, because of that horrible picture with the little boy.
Yeah,
the reason why I only use kids, teenagers in this movie is to make a point. Of course, there were also adults, German clearing minds. But as humans, we need a punch in the face to realize when something is wrong. That's the only way we will wake up. Otherwise, we'll just sit, oh, it's not my problem, it's not my thing, I can't relate to this, he's probably deserved it, yeah, he's only going up to get a few of our values. But when you see something that young, it becomes so painful because you know it's not their fault. It's the adults' wars. It always has been the adults' wars. But it's the children that are the prisoners of all these horrible things that happen, so.
So there's been, how long has this change been going on in Denmark, do you feel?
I mean, it's Denmark is, you know, a country that, you know, we shake our hands with like every other country, we shake our hand, we don't, seems like we don't care whether it's Bush, Obama, or whoever comes knocking at our door. I would love our country to be like, nope, we cannot relate to that kind of politics. Nope, we cannot, have an opinion. So I could wake up in the morning and say, God damn, I'm proud of being Danish. And right now, I'm not.
So are you? Would you be considered a lefty in Denmark? Or are you
I'm not
more
a lefty.
Than norm?
I'm not a lefty. I'm just in the middle. I believe in a lot of values we have in Denmark, the whole social welfare system. Yeah. It's a beautiful country. There's just something wrong with the government right now that, and it took me by surprise.
This
it
is really a scare tactic. They use the scare tactic. They tell us that these immigrants are dangerous, and we're going to protect you. Yeah. You just have to vote for us. And unenlightened people, they jump straight into it, you know. And it's only the people who vote for these parties, they live on the countryside, and they never met an Arabian guy or anything. They only read about him in the newspaper, and the newspaper only take the drama stories, and because that's what sells newspapers, you know. So
if you live in the city, you don't really see it coming. And we were all thinking that the Social Democrats would actually win. So we were like, whoa, this is not going to happen when we saw the election. And it was just, Jesus. Mm. And so I think also as
great. But I think a change is going to come now. I can tell by the people. Normally, people, they sit on the internet and they hit a like button once in a while, you know, the passive activism, slackivism, I thought I heard somebody call it. But now they're on the streets. So I see a tendency to that the people are going to say nothing is enough now, because also when we travel around the world, I used to live in the States when I was 21, and I was really proud of Denmark because we had a social system and we had the school education and everything, you know. Now we don't almost tell anybody we're from Denmark. I'm from Scandinavia, you know. That actually pisses me off a lot. So, and I know when this movie is going to come out, we're going to have a lot of political debate with this movie. I'm going to use it to have my to say in this whole situation. That's for sure.
Well, it's fascinating because I think this movie will play in different countries as less political than it really is.
Of course it is, but it's like that's also a choice. From the very beginning, it's like the old Polish movie. How can you put your message in there without anybody noticing it, and slowly make it evolve into something?
Because we're definitely going through the same stuff in the United States these days. It's with Donald Trump being the loudmouth in chief at the moment.
Yeah. Is anybody taking him seriously? I mean,
there are people who are willing to vote for him, and it's he doesn't actually answer any questions about what he wants
to
do.
They need some hawks, I think.
Was going to do it.
Yeah.
Need some hawks?
They need some hawks. The people who vote for him. I don't think they got enough love.
Well, it's the same thing you were saying though before. It's there's a fear of things, you know, there's a fear of immigration in this country, even though there's been less immigration from Mexico in the last 5 years than the history of immigration.
You want to build a wall?
It's like at the lowest level, and then all he can talk about is a wall and keeping Mexicans out. So it's a weird, but the people who are afraid of it are people who don't know or live in Arizona where there's a particularly difficult problem. Or it's an interesting, you know, that use of fear to manipulate. I mean, it's certainly in our country, we've used it to go into pretty much every war since World War II, where it's just about kind of perpetuating the machine more than it is actually fighting anything that's really threatening us. So, you know, it's a problem. It's surprising when it's a problem in Denmark. It doesn't feel so surprising here.
I think the world is becoming smaller and smaller. You know, that when there is a problem somewhere, it becomes a problem all over.
We also like to compare ourselves with the States, especially some of our politicians like to do it. So maybe that's why, I don't know. Maybe they learned something from the wrong people in the States, in Denmark, I don't know. But they definitely compare them a lot to the States. And I'm always saying, it's like, well, you have death penalty in the States, but do you have less crime? Maybe you should motivate instead of try to control everything, you know? And every time they make a new rule, it takes something from all of us, some freedom from all of us, you know, and I think we should sit down and talk to each other and understand why and accept the differences we have, you know, make room for it. That's what makes the world a beautiful place. If everybody's dressed alike and think alike, and I would jump off a bridge down that city, you know, just to make a statement.
So this movie for you, if it plays as a significant thing in Denmark, that's important to you. Is the spread of this movie over the world very important to you?
Yeah, it is. Of course, it is. You would like your story to be seen or heard by a lot of people, and I think it would. As I saw in the screening the other day, people can relate to it and they enjoy it, so or fear it or whatever. I hope that it'll be sold around the world. And
does the feedback feel the same as it has when you screen it at home? I assume you screened it at home.
No, it hasn't been showed there yet. It's going to premiere the 3rd of December. So this is the world premiere. This is the first time we've ever showed it to anybody. So.
And the first showing felt like you had hit the note right, that you found the audience.
Yeah, it was amazing. We were so overwhelmed. It was like 6 or 7 minutes of standing ovation.
I relax now. I always, when I look at myself, I think I look stupid, I sound stupid, and I always think I can do it better. But after the screening we had, now I'm relaxed.
So now you're ready to come back to America and take over Hollywood?
He's
going to take over Hollywood, yeah.
And do you have any urge to come take over Hollywood, or are you happy? Well, at home?
No.
We
would love to go here, and we have several projects in. So
you're going to come to LA and make the comedy version of Land of Mine?
Musical. No, I'm not into comedies at all. I wouldn't. That's not my. I love watching comedies though, but no, I don't see myself as that funny.
You travel with a funny guy.
He's a comedian.
He made a movie called A Funny Man.
Yeah, but it wasn't funny.
No, it wasn't.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it.
Thanks.
Thank you, man.
You're welcome.
Thanks.
Thank you.